Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Stoat on Stage, The Travels of Ermine, Book 2, written by Jennifer Gray and read by Eloise Oxer. The dedication reads, "To everyone who made my trip to Australia truly amazing, Jennifer. To my beloved niece, Chiama, who has just been on a great adventure in Sydney, like our heroine, Ermine. Elisa."
Dame Sylvia Longstrom, care of Sydney Opera House, Sydney, New South Wales, Australia. Dear Sylvia, thank you very much for offering to have Ermine stay on her world travels. Since I adopted her, she has turned out to be a very determined young lady with a great sense of adventure. I'm sure she and Butterfly will get on like a house on fire. Ermine also likes to help out, so if you need anything fixing, she is definitely the one to ask. She will be arriving at 11:30 on Tuesday morning. I've told her to meet you at the Opera House. With best wishes, Maria, Grand Duchess Maria von Schnitzel. Chapter 1. At the Sydney Opera House. Sylvia Longstrom, the world's greatest opera singer, was feeling frazzled. There was only a week left before the curtain went up on her performance at the Sydney Opera House, and she was late for rehearsal again. The director would be cross, the cast would be cross, and Luciano Cingolotti, who was playing the main part opposite her, would probably storm off stage in one of his famous tantrums. Sylvia was never normally late, but having her 8-year-old granddaughter, Butterfly, to stay for the summer holidays made life much more complicated, especially as Butterfly thought opera sounded like a bunch of hyenas stuck in a dustbin. Thank goodness she had phoned her old friend Maria for advice on what to do, thought Sylvia. And what a stroke of luck that Maria had suggested that Ermine should come and stay as part of her world travels. It would be a wonderful surprise for Butterfly to have a friend to play with, particularly one as unusual as Ermine. Sylvia smiled to herself. She could hardly wait to see the look on her granddaughter's face when their guest arrived. But meanwhile, she had a rehearsal to go to. "Please hurry up, Butterfly," Sylvia begged. The opera house stood looking over the harbor. It was built on a great platform like an ancient temple, and Sylvia and Butterfly had only reached the first level. There was still another big set of steps to go before they got to the stage door.
"I don't want to!"
Butterfly dragged up the steps behind her grandmother. She was a slip of a girl with a gentle face and big dark eyes. Right now, though, she didn't look gentle at all. She looked positively ferocious. Her face wore a big scowl, and her thick, cropped hair poked out in all directions from under a baseball cap, which she had on back to front. The baseball cap was denim, like her dungarees and sneakers. She was also wearing odd socks.
"I want to climb the bridge!"
Sydney Harbour Bridge was probably the city's best-known landmark, apart from the Opera House. It formed a great arch over the harbor, and Butterfly had set her heart on climbing all the way up to the top of it and all the way down the other side on the famous bridge climb.
"We'll do that later," Sylvia promised.
"But I want to do it now!"
Butterfly sat down on the concrete.
"Butterfly," Sylvia pleaded. "I'm late for rehearsal, as it is. I need to practice."
"No, you don't," Butterfly said.
You just need to sing something decent, like Winifred Winnett does.
Her face brightened.
Her performing wallabies are awesome.
Winifred Winnett was a children's entertainer famous for songs such as Kevin the Kangaroo and Kiss Me Koala. To Sylvia's trained ear, it was clear that Winifred Winnett could barely sing a note. But everyone in Australia, including Butterfly, absolutely adored her. Winifred and her wallabies had won the biggest talent show on Australian TV for 2 years in a row and were hotly tipped to win this year's competition too, which was due to take place in just 2 days' time.
Australia's most awesome animal show.
Sylvia had thought it would be fun to get tickets. But since she'd learned about Ermine's visit, she'd had an even better idea. Just then, she heard a faint pattering behind her.
"Excuse me," said a voice. "I'm looking for Sylvia Lungstrom. Do you know where I can find her? Only this place is enormous, and I don't know where to go."
A brown, furry animal with a long, black-tipped, bushy tail, two coal black eyes, white whiskers, and a pink nose stood beside Butterfly. The creature was about as high as Butterfly's knee and was wearing a blue pinafore dress and a straw hat. A camera was slung over its shoulder, and in one paw it carried a small bag marked Toolkit.
"Ermine,"
Sylvia cried with relief.
"You're early."
"Sylvia,"
Ermine squeaked.
"It's you."
She removed a photograph from her pocket and examined it.
"You look just like your picture, except without the horns."
"I only wear those on stage," Sylvia explained. She bent down and regarded Ermine closely. "And you look just like your picture, too, except your fur is a different color."
"It's white in the winter,"
Ermine told her.
"But in the summer, it turns brown. We Stoats are very clever like that."
"You certainly are," Sylvia said. "By the way, this is my granddaughter, Butterfly." Ermine held out a paw.
"Hello," she said politely. "I'm Ermine."
Then,
"Did you fall over, or do you just like sitting on the floor?"
Butterfly gobbled at her.
"You can talk," she said. She'd forgotten all about her tantrum.
"Yes, but I can't sing,"
Ermine said sadly.
"At least not as well as your grandmother can."
She clasped her paws together and looked up at the opera house in awe. The roofs of the beautiful building towered above them like a set of billowing sails.
"I can't wait to go to the opera and hear you sing, Sylvia."
Ermine sighed.
"I can wear my feathered hat."
"Your what?"
Butterfly said, getting up.
"My feathered hat,"
Ermine repeated.
"The Duchess gave it to me."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.